Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to University United Methodist Church, where we believe that whoever you are and wherever you happen to be on your faith journey or your life journey, you are welcome here. You are beloved. It's a joy to see each and every one of you this morning. My name is Teresa, and I'm one of the pastors here today. And you probably have already caught on to this, but this morning is the Sunday in Advent when we receive the children's traditional annual Christmas pageant. So we're so excited to be receiving that. And one of the awesome traditions here at University UMC is that your adult sanctuary choir is also here representing the angel choir. And there's lots of exciting, you can clap for them, yeah, lots of exciting headgear. Yeah. It's gonna be a great thing. And before we begin worship, I know we usually do a lot of announcements at the end of service, but I do want to lift up a few things as we get started in worship this day. And while I'm sharing a few announcements, you can find those registration pads in your pews so that we can have a record of your attendance this day. A special welcome to any guests or visitors that are here today. If you're comfortable leaving a phone number or an email address, we can be in touch with you to see if you have any questions about our church. But one of the things I wanted to lift up and make sure that you're aware of is that next Sunday is Christmas Eve. It's coming quick, right? Christmas? So next week is Christmas Eve, and I want to share with you that we are going to continue to have an 11 o'clock service as we typically do on every Sunday, and we will be lighting the Christ candle. There will not be candlelight or communion at that earliest service at 11 a.m. It'll be somewhat informal, but there will be a lot of congregational Christmas carol singing, and I think it's the perfect kind of service for somebody who maybe doesn't want to drive at nighttime, or maybe you're heading out of town to see relatives. So we hope to see some of you at our 11 a.m. service. And then at 3:30 in the afternoon, we will have our traditional family-friendly service, which means you're probably catching on that that means that it'll be a little chaotic, but in a joyful kind of way. There will be kind of a pop-up children's pageant that Jillian and I have been working on, where all children can decide whether they want to be Mary or Joseph or an angel or a shepherd. And that means, yes, that we might have more than one Mary or more than one Joseph. It's going to be amazing. So we hope to see some of you there. And we will have communion and candlelight at that service as well. And then at 5:30 and 10:30 here in the sanctuary, we have our traditional Christmas Eve services with all the things, a very brief homily and then candlelight and communion. Again, we hope to see all of you at one or both of our Christmas Eve services. I also want to share with you that today, following this service, we are having our Advent Festival. People have made chili, and there's enough for everybody, vegetarian options included, and lots of activities that the staff has been working hard on. So I look forward to more time for fellowship following this worship service. At this time, let us stand as we are able in body and or spirit, and I invite one of our youth, Magnolia, to come forward as she leads us in the call to worship.
I knew joy, but when I heard the laugh of a child, suddenly joy was overflowing. I knew love, but when a friend held my hand, suddenly joy was overflowing. I knew God, but when you showed me grace, when you forgave me, loved me, and raised me, suddenly God was overflowing. So let us worship Holy God together as a reminder that God is here and we are never alone. This is community. This is the body of Christ. Welcome home.
December 17th, love. And now, faith, hope, and love remain, these three, and the greatest of these is love. 1 Corinthians 13.
I dream of music that makes my heart swell.
I dream of trees that take my breath away.
I dream of sunrises that wrap me in light.
I dream of dinners with friends that feel like home.
I dream of church services that give me hope.
I dream of love as the default.
So today, as we draw near to Christmas Day, we light the candle of love. May this light burn bright as a reminder that God is here and God is love. We are not alone. Thanks be to God for a love like that. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
May we rise and greet one another in the name of Christ.
Good morning, everyone. Does anybody ever wake up and have that feeling like something or like maybe it's just me, it's the allergies, I don't know. Good morning. As a faith community, we cherish our stories and our traditions. During Advent, we tell the story of the birth of Jesus. We tell it complete with children, with costumes, a podium, and you know it'll be printed out for you. It's like I don't know if you get this. I came prepared. You can probably read this from the front row there, so let's get into it. All right. So listen here again, these timeless words, and remember together how a tiny baby, born in a stable, brought God's love to the world. Once upon a time, isn't that how the good ones start? Once upon a time, in the land of Israel, there lived a couple named Joseph and Mary. Mary was getting ready to have a baby, right? This baby was sent by God to show God's love to the world. The angel said that the child should be called Jesus. While Mary and Joseph were waiting on their baby to come, the Emperor Augustus commanded all the citizens of the empire to return to their hometown so they could be counted. The emperor wanted to know how many people lived in the Roman Empire. Since both Joseph and Mary descended from the family of David, they had to go to their hometown of Bethlehem. When they reached Bethlehem, the town was filled with people who had all come in from the countryside to be counted by the Romans. Joseph and Mary went from inn to find a place to stay, but all the inns were full. Although people could see that Mary was about to give birth, angels, can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen, thank you. Since they could tell she was about to give birth, there was no place for them in Bethlehem. Can you imagine Mary and Joseph, how they felt? They were tired and cold and needed a place to rest. Finally, they found a place to stay in a warm stable with all the animals. And it was there that baby Jesus was born. This all happened a long time ago, but every year we remember that God's love is given to us through Jesus, who came as a baby.
On the night Jesus was born, the shepherds were tending their sheep in the field near Bethlehem. Suddenly, a great light shone upon them, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them. The shepherds were frightened by the vision, but the angel said to them,
"Be not afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy for all people. For there is born to you this day in Bethlehem, the city of David, a Savior who is the Messiah. You will find the baby in a stable wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger."
Then all of a sudden, the shepherds saw the sky was filled with angels, and the shepherds heard them praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards all."
When the angels had left, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this birth that has taken place, which God has made known to us."
Lead to the place where the Christ was.
The shepherds told Mary and Joseph all that the angels had said about their baby, and Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. And as the shepherds knelt to pay honor to the Christ child, the friendly beasts gathered around the Christ child to bring the new baby comfort and love.
Joseph and Mary remained in Bethlehem for several days. Inside the stable, the shepherds and animals continued to surround Mary, Joseph, and the baby. Outside the stable, a beautiful star shone bright in the dark sky above the stable.
Then one night, three strangers appeared in the little town of Bethlehem, dressed in rich clothing of bright colors. They had traveled from the Far East. They were people of great learning and wisdom, and had spent many years studying the stars and the mysteries of the world. Often such wise people were called magi by the people in their land.
These magi had seen a new magnificent star appear in the sky. They remembered the prophets said that a great leader would be born in the world and that a great star would lead them to the birthplace. The Magi began to follow the star so that they could show honor to the newborn child.
The Magi followed the star until it stopped over the stable where Jesus was born. When they saw the child, they knew at once this was the leader they sought. They knelt before Jesus and presented gifts of gold and rare perfumes called frankincense and myrrh.
And so it is that a baby dressed in swaddling clothes was brought into the world and was called Jesus. And the animals, the shepherds, and the magi bowed before him because they knew that this baby was the Messiah, the light of the world who brings peace. May our presentation of the nativity scene remind all of us to keep the story of Christmas close to our hearts during this Christmas season and always.
Friends, I was going to have us thank our children. Let's do it loud enough so that they can hear us. Thank you. And to all the big kids, to all the big kids that shepherded them, what a joy, what a joy. Thank you. As we continue in worship, I invite Brielle and Amanda to the pulpit as they share with us a reading.
Hi everyone, I'm Brielle.
Hi, good morning, I'm Amanda. Today, we're sharing a piece entitled Joy Like Water, written by Sarah R. of A Sanctified Art. The Sanctified Art liturgy has been used in several of our calls to worship and Advent wreath lighting this season. Joy Like Water is a modern day retelling of the angel Gabriel's visit to Mary and Mary's visit to her cousin Elizabeth.
Joy Like Water, Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 45. Mary went to Elizabeth's house, because that's what we do when the world falls apart. That's what we do when the script is flipped, when the rug is pulled, when it rains inside. We go home, we find friends, we find love.
So Mary went to Elizabeth's house, harboring good news that must have felt like water. Something capable of helping her float or pulling her under. And only then, only there, in the presence of a face that looked like love, does the word joy appear.
Mary said, "How can this be?" The angel said, "Do not be afraid." Mary said, "May it be so." But when Mary went to Elizabeth's house, and Elizabeth opened the door, joy, like a tipped cup of water, spilled out everywhere.
I imagine that Elizabeth laughed. I imagine that Mary framed her growing belly. I imagine that both women pressed palms to stomach when that baby began to kick. A holy ritual as old as time, I imagine that God smiled. And I imagine that for the first time, Mary could float.
Isn't it always that way? I could harbor joy to myself. I could tuck joyful moments deep into pockets, saving memories of better days for long nights. But when I share my joy with you, when you open the door, joy spills out everywhere, and it is love that helps me float.
Amen.
Friends, would you please join me in the prayer for illumination? O great dreamer, as we hear the scripture read, pour out your spirit on our hearts and minds so that we see what you see. Open our eyes to both the world's suffering and the world's beauty. As you long for justice and peace, give us the courage to dream what you dream. Gratefully we pray. Amen. And now, hear Luke 1:46 through 55. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowly state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Indeed, his mercy is for those who fear him, from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his child Israel in the remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. The word of God for the people of God.
Microphone's not on. Can you hear me now? Yes. We're talking about Christmas pageants. So thank you, Unju. You know what this means is that it was probably on during all the congregational singing. Nice. Okay. So here we are. I'm telling you that when I was a kid, I was jealous of those magi because I thought they had better costumes, although they paled in comparison to the wise men that I saw today. Those were really fancy. Ours were mostly like the dad's bathrobe, but the thing that I loved was the cardboard cutout crowns that were wrapped in aluminum foil, maybe with some glitter on them. I always wanted to be the magi. All joking aside, I think as a child, I never fully understood the spotlight that Mary stands under. Our foreparents in the faith called her Theotokos. That was one of the names given to Mary, which in Greek means the one who bears God, the one who carries God to others, the one who embodies the things of God, the things of hope and love, peace and joy. Words deceptively simple yet so powerful, we light candles in their honor each Advent season. Theotokos, the one who bears and carries these things to others. Well, in this morning's worship service, we've already received the children's Christmas pageant again, and we've heard about Mary and her visit to her cousin Elizabeth. And I find so many lessons that these women have to teach us. This visit embodies a great deal of lessons, I think, about what it means to be the church together today. For starters, Mary and Elizabeth remind us that being part of a faith community means not having to go at life alone. The angel visits Mary, and she is no doubt overwhelmed with this news that she will give birth to the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And she has all sorts of questions, like any of us would. How can this be? The angel Gabriel has to assure her, "Do not be afraid, Mary." But when Mary is told about her cousin Elizabeth, she has no more questions. And she seems to be at peace, at least as much as she can be. "Let it be," she says. I can imagine her still being overwhelmed with all that's taking place, but after hearing that her cousin is also going through a similar experience, that she will have another woman to talk to on this journey that she's setting forth on, she is more at peace. In a similar way, one of the ways that I experience this here at University UMC is in our caregivers support group that continues to meet and is growing. They accompany one another on a journey. Church means being Elizabeth to one another. And when we are at our best, church is also about living life with one another and sharing dreams. In the Gospel of Luke, Mary at first seems resolved to God's plan. She no doubt is obedient and faithful, but it feels like it's sort of a, okay, let this be, it's going to happen kind of a way. It's only when she shares her news with Elizabeth that her yes becomes a rejoicing kind of yes. There is a safe presence in Elizabeth with her. And her yes, Mary's yes, is transformed. Transformed as she is caught up in a dream that filled her heart and her vocal cords with joy and overflowing. Dreams are meant to be shared, and church, when we are at our best, is a place not only for dreams to be shared, but for us to do that across the generational lines. Mary, the younger, and Elizabeth, the older. I wonder if you know that in our society today, the church or other faith communities, this is one of the last places in our society where the generations intentionally connect. Here, children have extended family, additional cousins, and grandparents in the faith. We older members have the opportunity to mentor and share, and no doubt we learn from the younger as well, including those up there. I see you. Mary reminds us that dreams are to be shared, and she also reminds us that dreams point beyond ourselves. It's kind of like this: I may wish to run a really fast half marathon, but I'm not quite sure that that is in keeping with God-sized type dreams. If you wear an Apple Watch, some days my Apple Watch will buzz at like 10:30 at night and it'll say, "You can still do it. You can still get your 10,000 steps." And I'm like, "I don't think that's going to happen today." But you get the point. Wishes and goal setting, that's all well and good for our own self-improvement. But God-sized dreams point away from our self-interests, oriented towards the common good for all people and all of creation. It is for all of God's people to flourish. The spirit of this message was captured beautifully by one of our youth in the devotional book that we've been using this Advent season, written by members of our church. I hope some of y'all are using that Advent devotional book. And one of our youth, Eliza, shared this at the close of her devotional, and she gave me permission to share this. She said, "I still go to bed on Christmas Eve with leaping joy and endless curiosity about the coming day. But as I get older, I find my subconscious expanding my thoughts beyond gifts and actually analyzing the true meaning of Christmas, love and forgiveness. My ideas shift from gifts that I might receive to the gifts that I can give others." Isn't that beautiful? My ideas shift from the gifts that I can receive to the gifts that I can give others. This is the kind of dreaming God calls us to. And the church is a place for us to share those dreams. We dream together, eyes wide open, as we've been talking about this Advent season, eyes open as we are awake to the realities of the world, both the beauty and the pain. Eyes closed as we imagine, as we picture and dream a better world, a world as it could be, a world as it should be. Eyes open again to do our part, to live and act in such a way that dreams flourish. Dreams of the hungry being filled with good things, and the powerful who abuse their power to be thrown off their thrones. Mary teaches us all about this, and she does so by singing to us this lesson. I shared this earlier, that this is one of the few places in our society where the generations interact, and it is also in faith communities where we experience the power of singing together. Where else do we do that in our daily living? Some of you are involved in choirs apart from church or singing ensembles, but for most of us, worship on Sunday morning is the place during our week where we sing together with other people. Even beyond faith communities, other people have acknowledged the power of communal singing. It was not long ago in an NPR article where somebody was interviewed and they said this: lifting voices together in praise can be a transcendent experience, unifying a group of people in a way that is somehow both fervent and soothing. Scientists go on to say that there is actually a physical basis for those feelings. Specifically, it was in a publication called Frontiers in Neuroscience that an article confirms the power of choir music. And none of these people told me to preach this. This article says, scientists have researched, and it says that choir music has calming effects on the heart, especially when sung in unison. If you come to worship for no other reason than to sing together, singing hymns that in my mind always leave in the music a little room for space and grace to ponder what we believe theologically. If you come to worship for no other reason than to sing and to interact with people who are not your own age, that's a good thing. In just a moment, our children are going to come and sing for us. And you can all join. Alicia tells me the Y'all Come Christmas Eve choir concert or choir piece. All of you are invited on Wednesday night to join choir practice and join together in singing on Christmas Eve. Whether you join the choir or sing in your pews, I pray that as a congregation, we will continue to dream together and we will continue to sing and dream the songs of our faith. May it be so. Amen.
Thank you so much for the beautiful music. And as you enter this sanctuary this morning, you may notice these blankets on the altar rails and on the altar. And these blankets are made by our church members and also several others in the Austin area. And these blankets will be delivered to neonatal intensive care units and will be given to the parents of premature babies. And each blanket was made with love and prayers. And now it is our time to add one more prayer in our pastor prayer. Let us pray. O come, Emmanuel, in this time of Advent, with holy anticipation, we come to you and pray for the precious lives you have brought into the world. Although our nights have not been silent, calm, or bright, although this world which our children will inherit is violent and unjust, we give you thanks today for the gift of hope, the hope for the world that you are creating with us, and for the gift of dream, the dream of peace with justice. O come, Emmanuel, we seek refuge in you today. Instill in us the values of your kingdom of love. Break into our lives so we can find the wonders etched in our children's eyes. Let us trust in your way of making all things whole. Let us feel your presence and your unfailing mercy as we try to let go of our anxieties and worries. God, who is a parent, who bears, gives birth, and nurtures life, bless these blankets and the children who receive them, born before their time, yet made in your image. We pray they will grow stronger every day. We pray for their parents. May they feel your love and strength. We pray for the doctors and nurses who care for these small ones. Give them wisdom and gentle hands as they give care to the babies. We ask this in the name of the one who came as a baby and whose name is Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Ushers may come forward.
I now invite you to stand if you are able. With joyful hearts, we offer ourselves and our gifts to God. This weekend, on Friday, the youth had a lock-in here at the church. We played lots of games, we watched movies, including Barbie, and ate lots of yummy food. We are so grateful to Natasha and Jillian, who continue to provide programs and lots of activities for us here at the church. Yesterday morning, we also volunteered with Open Door and Fig Leaf, and we are glad to be at such an amazing church that is compassionate and in service. And for all our gifts, we give God thanks.
May our offerings be signs of your gifts to the whole world, bringing healing and reconciliation.
As we prepare for our closing hymn, I remind you that next door in our fellowship hall, there is chili for everybody and some activities. We hope that you'll linger for a little bit to visit with one another, enjoy some good food during our Advent festival. I also remind you of the Christmas Eve services I spoke about earlier in the back of our bulletin. There's lots going on in the life of our church over the next couple of months, and you'll want to take a look and see what you want to be involved in. We know that at this time of the year, we hear songs like, it's the most wonderful time of the year, and yet we realize that this time of the year is difficult for a lot of people for a host of reasons. And if you or somebody you love is either maybe in grief, maybe it's the first Christmas without a special loved one or friend, or maybe this is just a time of the year where your heart is filled with memories that are not all cheerful, or you're maybe lonely, feeling a little depressed, this is all normal. And one of the things that many churches have done in response to these experiences is offered a longest night of the year service, also called a Blue Christmas. And Alicia has been taking the lead on a Tuesday evening service this week at 7:30 in our chapel. It was a beautiful time last year, an intimate space with some Dizay singing and prayer time and sharing. If that is a type of service that appeals to you and you are able to come, we hope to see all of you. As well, on December 21st, that Thursday, and all this will be in our eConnection newsletter, we'll have an online version of that as well so that you can share that resource with family and friends. Friends, at this time, as we prepare to sing our closing hymn, I invite, as we sing, all of the parents of babies that were born within this last year into our faith community to come forward and bring those babies with you. So we're going to join together in singing Infant Holy, Infant Lowly. It's in our hymnals, and as we sing, parents and babies, come on down.
Infant Holy, Infant Lowly, for His bed on high. I am so grateful that all these babies could be here. Today we have Sage and David and Bennett and May. And haven't they been born into the most loving and nourishing community ever? Yeah. So we wanted to welcome them with baby ornaments and say Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Jillian. A beautiful tradition here at University UMC. The ornament is a little block with their initial and name on it. Baby's First Christmas from University UMC. And again, I'm grateful for these babies, for you as a church community, for all of our children that participated in the children's pageant, as well as all of those adults who, it was like they were, what do you call it? Herding donkeys down here, not cats, donkeys. But it was a great joyful time. And Jillian, thank you so much for all that you did to make this worship service happen. Thank you, Jillian. I don't think any of us know all the different moving parts, but she's been trained well by Pastor Heather, and this is the first children's pageant. And so thank you for your leadership. Friends, again, Advent Festival next door, and I want to leave you with these words as we continue to sing and dream together. May these babies and all of the children who participated in this worship service, may the joy that they brought you inspire you and empower you to go forth and dream dreams for all children in all places throughout the world. Amen. Amen. Come out.